Hello, malty Malaysian mobsters. Welcome to Whisky Review 540 here in the Manx Bothy at Ralphie.com. And thank you to Skinnard Leonard for that malt mention, introducing a review of our Scotch single malt. It's what I focus on in my whisky reviews, Scotch single malts. I buy quite a lot of it, although I have to add, not quite as much as I used to. There we go. Sign of the times. I'm going to pour this glass of whiskey. I'm going to introduce the bottle. I'm going to tell you a little bit about it. And then I'm going to add some added malty extras. There we go. And the reason's simple. You can only learn so much from people giving you descriptors of an individual bottle of any spirit, any, take your pick. Scotch whiskey, Japanese whiskey, whiskey from anywhere else in the world, rum, tequila, bourbon, rye. There's a lot of options out there, and an awful lot of commentators tend to focus specifically on the merits and smell and taste, and along with the orthodox marketing messages like where the water comes from and the size of the stills and all that stuff. And really, that only tells you so much. There's so much more which is really useful to you in developing and having more confidence in your own palate and your own judgment. It makes you a discerning, fussy customer. And that, for some people in the whisky industry, is a nightmare. I know, I have to shoulder some of the blame. Anyway, I'd like you to do me a favour, just while I'm strolling this single malt round the glass, just before I introduce it, tell you a bit more details. I'd like you to leave your mobile phone in another room so you can't be disturbed. Close the door behind you so you can't be disturbed by noisy family members or friends with the best of intentions, want to talk sport and stuff. Make time for yourself, for your individual malt moment. Even if you're sitting with a whisky club somewhere, enjoying a little bit of malt banter, a little bit of cask camaraderie, you really want to have a little bit of time to yourself to focus your smell and your taste into what's in the glass. It's not so much going on a flavour hunt, it's just making the mellow malt mood to allow it to come to you in its own time. And remember, because we need to remember these things, it's quality that you're looking for, not quantity. Not quantity at all. I wouldn't recommend too much quantity of this particular single malt. It is bottled at cask strength. It's Benriach, 1999. 15-year-old Scotch single malt. It is a sherry edition, quite popular at this moment, fashionable at this moment in time as your finishing culture, and this is no exception. It's a Pedro Ximenez sherry finish, is what they call it, literally they call it finish. Selected and bottled, well, every whiskey selected and bottled, so that's just flannel. Exclusively, well, exclusive, when you see exclusive, just dismiss it immediately, because it's one of the most pretentious, overused, frankly bullshitty terms used for marketing anything for the UK. Now, that first of all suggests to me, and I don't mean to be cynical here, Mom, now you know me, you know me, but in my experience, UK customers are the most tolerant, unfussy whisky drinkers in the whole of Europe. Well, Northern Europe. And will tend to tolerate poorer quality than other areas of the world. Now, I'm generalising, I know, I'm just saying that anecdotally. I'm not stating it as a fact. I'm stating it as an opinion based on my experiences. living in the UK. It's bottled at a whacking 55.4%, so quite definitely cask strength. It gives you some reasonable information on the little label at the top there. There's gives you a bottle number. It says it's cask number 9150, if that helps you track this one down, if you're particularly interested. Bottled in November 2014 from a Pedro Jimenez sherry puncheon. They give you some tasting notes. Tasting notes are there for guidance and flannel and to talk up and suggest to you what you should be tasting in the whiskey rather than you finding out for yourself. My advice is just ignore tasting notes. They can actually be confusing depending which distillery they come from. That's about as much as I need to say before I add some water. 55.4%. I'm going to add quite a bit of water. 15 years old. What expectations do I have? Well, none. It's a Pedro Jimenez finish. Does that mean that it's been finished for 1 day, 1 week, 1 month, 1 year? Does it mean that the previous cask was underactive? Does it mean that the previous cask during for maturation was flawed? Does it mean that basically the distillery was saying, well, we're having such a lot of success with our sherry matured Glendronachs, which are quite popular at the moment, quite fashionable, let's just extend it to our sister distillery, Benriach? And just before I go any further, I must comment that the Glendronach Whiskey Company, they've done a pretty good job of connecting with the customers. If you were a distillery and you were looking for motivation as to modern, contemporary customer and consumer engagement, you'd look at the Glendronach Appreciation Society in Facebook and you would see a very good template which more distillers should use to actually engage with one-to-one conversation in a mutual fan club of a single malt and do so proactively. It's not rocket science. It's just a marketing department who are thinking outside the box and who are not stuck in the mud in conventional, traditional marketing messaging through expensive, ineffective, traditional media. There we go. That was an opinion. Now we've allowed this whiskey to settle down the glass. I put my nose to it and I'm smelling something I've smelled before, several occasions. I shall come back to that when I tell you about a fine old Spanish tradition which was quite fashionable in the Scotch whisky industry in the 1930s to 1980s. Until it went out of favour. I'll come back to that shortly. I've smelt this smell before. That fresh fruit, assertive, dominant sherry sweet note, which acts as quite a blanket to Scotch malt whisky at times. Now what I'm looking for is I didn't buy a bottle of prune juice here, alcoholic prune juice. I bought a bottle of single malt whiskey. It's featured as part of my buying whiskey in 2015 vlog that I did a few vlogs ago. And it was suggested as a good option by a couple of malt mates, and I'm following through on this. Initially, I was not impressed with this at all, I've got to tell you. This was very much the finishing cask dominating everything, and the balance, the synergy that you get from tangible spirit and cask communion wasn't there. I have persevered, and such is the eccentric chameleon character of Benriach single malt, which in my opinion is still underrated as one of Scotland's little classic single malts. Over time, over a couple of weeks, the spirit has started to exert itself over that huge sherry avalanche that is your first experience of this on the nose and in the taste. This is one of these bottles of single malts that you decant it about three times just to shake it up, oxygenate it, and just encourage it to lose that whacking great sherry dominance, which takes you back to the suspicion that you've bought a bottle of prune juice. On the nose, brown sugar, muscovado, Pedro Jimenez sherry, loads of it, gallons of it, shitloads of it, too much of it. I know it's a sherry monster, but not all monsters are nice monsters. It's starting to tone down a little bit, thank goodness, and we're starting to see a more positive side where the single malt itself, the fruitiness of the single malt, which has been masked by the fruitiness of the sherry cask, is starting to kind of come back into the frame, into the picture, and give an awful lot more colour and tone. Some lovely mixed citrus going on, rind, a little bit of the white pithiness in the nose, that little bitter note, and the juice, lime juice, grapefruit juice, mandarin juice. These range of fruit bursts. There's a confectionery that consists of various citrus fruits, and they're chews, and you can buy them in the UK, and I'm getting quite a bit of that here in the nose. Yes, there's honey, yes, there's a touch of coffee going on, but still, even now that an awful lot of the running is being made by this fresh, almost confectionery, well, yeah, not almost, nothing about almost, totally confectionery sherry note. Taste. It tastes quite rye. Wild turkey rye. The arrival is very fast, very rapid, sweet and sour. Very different from the nose. Totally different from the nose. All the heavy cloying sweetness and fresh sherry, immature sherry, is not there. You're getting something that's more bitter, wood sour, but not cask influenced. Development is fairly medium. For a 15-year-old whisky, this is behaving like an 8-year-old, which is kind of reflective, in my opinion, of the previous cask that it's originally been matured in. Very much a sour note, rye influenced. That wood bitter coming through now more strongly. Treacle, sherry flavour, sherry essence, as you would get for baking products. I'm not making this sound too attractive, I know, but bear with me, malt mates. As always, I'm just giving you an honest opinion and not seeking to justify it one way or the other. I'm going to add a bit more water. I know I'm kind of tasting it rather quickly after adding the water. I just want to see how the dilution is influencing things. What's interesting is that there's a re-emergence of fruit from the single malt. The spirit itself is saving the day here. It really is. If you add enough water, you'll notice that the spirit, the Benriach, re-exerts itself as the influence of this finish, Pedro Jimenez finish, is quite physically, literally diluted. And it starts to bring some more character back into this single malt. And my goodness, it needs it. Some sour now. Good, now we're getting a bit more development. The form is stretching. It started off with a really short form. Now the form's starting to stretch a little bit. But the sour is a little bit two-dimensional. Right. Finish. Sweet and sour chicken. With raisins and sultanas. Without too much chicken influence. But do you know they get these sweet and sour mixed sauces for stir fries? That's what I'm getting. I think you're getting the pattern here, malt mates. I'm going to give this 81 out of 100. It's a malt mark. It's a very good example of what is exclusively bottled for the UK market. So if you feel to yourself, oh no, how can I get hold of this single malt because it's only available in the UK, it's not available where I am, don't worry, malt mates, you might not be missing much. And bear in mind, have a look at what's bottled exclusively for where you are, because if you are a developing market or an important market where the Scotch whisky industry is trying to boost sales, and you see anything exclusively bottled for your specialist shops, well, see if you can get a taste of it, because you may find where they're making a big effort to make a good impression, that's where you're going to find your better whiskies. It's just natural law. Natural law is fascinating. It's learned so much from natural law. It's what happens that influences the human condition without the human beings really understanding what it is or just being in denial about it. But the great thing about avoiding being in denial is when someone comes along and just shares a little precious malt moment with you so that you know a little bit more, you're a little bit more informed, and as such you're more empowered. Now, that's the reason for this little bottle of stuff. Does it look like E150A caramel colourant? Well, it does actually. It's certainly brown enough, but I've got E150A caramel colourant here. It tends to be more viscous and syrupy. This is a little less so. It's more kind of like a black dew, Manachmore with loads of caramel in it. Arguably the worst whiskey ever bottled. Not quite, but it's in the running. Well, this is Paxaret, pronounced in Spanish as Pajaret. And very popular in the 18th century, you see. And look it up, by the way. Do your Google search or go to Wikipedia. If you know about Paxaret, it will give you quite a useful point of reference. I'm not going to embellish any more than that, because I don't want to sound too cynical. It will give you a very useful point of reference to modern sherry finishes and whiskey. Paxaret was used from the 1930s onwards, increasingly so up to about the 1980s, for reinvigorating sherry casks for maturing Scotch whiskey. Now, the way it worked was this. Paxaret is a condensed sherry syrup used for making desserts and used for sherrying up sherry casks. In the 18th century, it was a popular, rich, syrupy dessert wine drunk in its own right, and apparently could be very good indeed, because it kept well, particularly in cold countries. It had a richness and a condensed treacly type character of dried fruit, which was very refreshing for the Northern European palate. Bear in mind, Pedro Ximenez grapes generally can be dry, but it's generally a sweet sherry, which is used by Spaniards as a drizzle over ice cream because it's so sweet, or as a dessert wine, or mixed with fresh lemonade as a long drink. But Paxarette was in favour with the Scotch whisky industry, because if they had an exhausted sherry cask that they wanted to reinvigorate, what they'd do is they'd put about half a litre of this Paxarette, P-A-X-A-R-E-T-T-E, that's the spelling of it, into a hogshead. If it was a butt, by the way, it would be a full litre of this syrup. And they would then put the cask under pressure by putting a seal over the bung in the cask and pushing in steam, which would heat the inside of the cask, open up the wood pores, expand the wood, and by rolling it around a little bit, the Paxarette would be absorbed a few millimetres into the surface of the wood, where it would lodge. They would then pour out what was left, and they were essentially juicing up the cask for maturing whisky, principally malt whisky, but also some grain whisky. Now, this may sound like an epic cheat. I am not saying that, and I'll tell you why. Because I've tasted Paxarette matured blended whiskies from auction, and they were really quite impressive. However, I do wonder to myself, and I'm sharing this with you because I want you to think about it too, is the modern phenomenon of finishing single malt whiskies, or whatever words they want to call it, is this just the emperor's new clothes for the old habit of Paxaretting whisky, where you identify an underperforming cask and you beef it up with a flavoursome overcoat, which happens to be fashionable and the mood of the moment, and people will get that initial expected tasting note-led experience and then be content to feel reassured that the money they've spent has been money well spent. Be critical, be a little bit cynical, not too harsh, but be in charge, malt mates, and to be aware of the history of the Scotch whisky industry that is a little less glamorous, but really quite important all the same. It is empowering to have perhaps a more balanced perspective on what happens to be the transient production practices of the moment. I want to finish by saying that I'm not accusing or suggesting that finishing of whiskies is a nouveau or neo-Paxaretting. That's a bit harsh. But what I am suggesting is that there is some common ground in the process. And I do wonder to myself, when you taste a sherry matured whisky where the sherry is so fresh, so unmatured, so syrupy. I do wonder if the casks, the sherry casks, prior to maturing whisky in Scotland are being carefully prepared with a little added extra in Spain. I don't know. I'm just putting the question out there as something for you to think about. Is it a good thing? Is it a bad thing? The bottom line is, when you taste the whisky that you're buying, is it worth the money you paid? That's important. A lot of people in the whisky, well, a few people in the whisky industry, just don't like me saying these things. However, people who have been a long time in the whisky industry and know whisky and care about their job, they understand that people educating, being informed, thinking about what they're drinking, what they're experiencing, that is good for the future reputation, not just of Scotch single malts, but of all spirits. Persevering, pioneering, pushing for, and investing in quality for the sake of quality. Even if the profit margins drop just a little bit, who cares? Because profits tend to get siphoned out and they go up to where they are squandered. Yes, squandered. You never squander any profit when you're investing in the calibre of the commodity for the future of its reputation. Enough said. Thank you for watching. Will I add some Paxaret, do you think, to my single malt? Would it improve it? Some single malts, you know, I like them all, but some single malts are just that little bit harder to like more. Goodbye, malt mates. See you soon.